God bless you, my brothers and my sisters. This is the day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Thank you so much for joining Mount Pisgah on today. I do give honor to the Spirit of Christ that rests in this place, and to all of you, God's people, and happy Mother's Day to all of our mothers, especially my mother. And I pray that you have a wonderful day. I recognize that you can't celebrate as you normally do, but I trust that God will bless you and he will grant you much peace and much mercy. I want to get right into the Word of God on this morning. I will be coming from the Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 15th chapter. And I will begin reading at the 21st verse. And I'm reading out of the CSB translation. And it reads as thus. It says, when Jesus left there, he withdrew to the area of Tyre and Sidon. Just then, a Canaanite woman from that region came and kept crying out, have mercy on me, Lord, son of David. My daughter is severely tormented by a demon. Jesus did not say a word to her, and his disciples approached him and urged him, send her away, because she's crying out after us. He replied, I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. But she came, knelt before him, and said, Lord, help me. He answered, it isn't right to take the children's bread and throw it to the dogs. Yes, Lord, she said, yet even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table. Then Jesus replied to her, woman, your faith is great. Let it be done for you as you want. And from that moment, her daughter was healed. Let us pray. Father God, in Jesus' name, Lord, we come to you now. Lord, we thank you for your bountiful blessings that you've bestowed upon us. I pray, God, that you will anoint me afresh as I deliver this word. I decrease that you might increase. I pray, God, that your people will be edified, but most of all, God, that you will be glorified. And we give your name the praise, the honor, and the glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Again, the 28th verse says, then Jesus replied to her, woman, your faith is great. Let it be done for you as you want. And from that moment, her daughter was healed. I want to talk for a few moments from this thought, a mother's faith. A mother's faith. Hebrews 11:1 says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. 2 Corinthians 5:7 says, for we walk by faith, not by sight. My brothers and my sisters, faith is at the core of our belief in God, and it is what compels us to follow Jesus as our Lord and Savior. As a believer, faith is a part of our daily existence, and it is through faith that we trust God for everything that we need, whether it be spiritually, physically, materially, emotionally. There is nothing that we cannot believe God for. Our text this morning demonstrates a wonderful lesson about faith. When you read again verse 22, you will find that we have a Canaanite woman who has a daughter that is grievously vexed with a devil. The scripture does not reveal how long the daughter has had this devil or this demon, what type of demon it is, what type of disruption this demon has caused. Apparently, the mother has heard about Jesus and his ability to heal sickness and disease and his ability to cast out demons. She believes, despite how long the daughter has had the demon and what type of demon it is, she believes that Jesus can handle it. My brothers and my sisters, this is so important because we must understand that regardless of what our situation is, regardless of how bad it has gotten, regardless of how long you have been dealing with it, you must know without a shadow of a doubt that Jesus has the ability to handle it. And so because this mother has this faith, and because this woman has this belief that Jesus can handle it, it calls her to move forward, and it causes her to seek out Jesus. The text shows us that when she approaches Jesus, the first thing that she asks for is mercy. This mother, she appeals to the compassion of Jesus and pleads with him out of her own compassion that she has for her daughter. Let me say that again. This mother appeals to the compassion of Jesus and pleads with him out of her own compassion for her daughter. You must understand, my brothers and my sisters, that mothers, when they have compassion for their children, that they will move out of that compassion to ensure that their children have what they need. And so notice this, that this woman, she approaches Jesus asking for mercy because she knew that mercy suited her case. And notice this, that she acknowledges Jesus as Messiah. Notice the language that she uses. She accepts the identity of Jesus even when his own people did not accept it. And she says, Lord and Son of David. Both of these titles signify the identity of the Messiah, which shows that this woman is placing Jesus in proper perspective. Not only does this demonstrate that she is placing Jesus in proper perspective, but it reveals the level and the depth of her faith. But notice this in verses 23 through 25. Jesus did not say a word to her. His disciples approached him and urged him, send her away because she's crying out after us. Here in the 24th verse it says, he replied, I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. The 25th verse, but she came, knelt before him and said, Lord, help me. The first thing that we learn about this mother's faith is that faith must be persistent. Yeah, faith must be persistent. The disciples see this woman as being a problem rather than having a problem. They are trying to carry out the ministry of Jesus, and this woman is getting in their way. Notice this, that this woman to the disciples that is being a distraction. She's causing problems. And isn't it something that how these disciples, they are missing the whole point of ministry. They were there in that region to carry out the ministry of Jesus, and they miss the point of their ministry. They misinterpret this woman's cry. And isn't it something, my brothers and sisters, how many times when we are in a place of desperation, we will come to the house of the Lord and we will cry out to the Lord and we will lift up praise unto the Lord. And this is the house of prayer. This is the place that we render praise unto God. And then you have those critics who are on the side watching, and they're trying to figure out, why in the world is she making that noise? Why is he making that noise? But this is the place that we need to come to get what we need from God. And so it is that this woman, she comes to Jesus because she knew that Jesus was the one who could remedy her problem. Notice this, that although she has the criticism by the disciples, and although Jesus is not saying anything, the Bible says that Jesus says not a word, and so she has these critics, and Jesus is not saying anything immediately, this woman is still unwilling to give up. The Bible says that she is kneeling before Jesus, and she keeps on seeking Jesus, and she refuses to give up until Jesus gives her an answer. My brothers and my sisters, many times people will start seeking Jesus, but they will give up when Jesus does not answer them immediately. People will start out seeking Jesus and trusting Jesus, and will stop trusting Jesus when they don't get what they want. But what we see in this text is that you cannot give up, regardless of your critics. Even when it seems that Jesus is being silent, you must be willing to persist, and you must be willing to seek Jesus regardless of what it cost. Notice this, my brothers and my sisters, that this woman, she continues to seek Jesus. She continues to pursue Jesus. And I heard someone say one time that persistence is stubbornness with a purpose. We learn the value in this text. We learn the value of being persistent. A perseverance and persistence is a key quality in our walk with God. We must have the ability to keep on during difficulty. We must have the ability to keep on when we are experiencing our personal challenges, because when we learn how to persevere, when we learn how to endure, when we learn how to be persistent, it helps develop our faith. It helps develop our spiritual growth. And you must understand, my brothers and my sisters, that despite when it looks like Jesus is silent, you still must be persistent. So we see here in the text that faith is persistent. But notice this in the 26th through the 27th verse. He answered her, "It is not right to take the children's bread and throw it to dogs." "Yes, Lord," she said, "yet even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table." The second thing that we see about faith is that faith humbles us. Yes, faith humbles us. Notice that this mother is on her knees pleading to Jesus. And Jesus again makes it clear that his mission is to spread the gospel to the Jews first and then the Gentiles. Jesus references, the dinner table, and this was not so much about the dog, but it was about the children. The priority is going to be feeding the children or the lost sheep of the house of Israel, and not the dogs, not the Gentiles. But notice the response of this woman. She says, "Even the dogs," hallelujah, "eat the crumbs from the master's table." In other words, this woman is saying that even the crumbs have enough power, and I don't need the whole loaf, because the crumbs of your ability can heal and deliver my daughter. The woman is willing to take whatever Jesus was willing to give, and that was enough for this woman. Notice this, that we learn the proper attitude to approach Jesus from this woman. And we need to learn how to humble ourselves before him. We need to be willing to bow in his presence and focus solely on him. Because if Jesus would have responded to us the way that he responds to this woman, many of us would have been offended, and we would have responded, "Who does he think he is? Do he know who I am? Does he know how many times I come to church? Does he know how many offerings I give? Does he know how often I sing on the choir, and how often I usher, and how often I preach?" And many of us would become offended at his response. But how many of us understand that faith will humble us? Faith will make us surrender our pride. Faith will make us surrender our sense of entitlement, and faith will humble us to the degree that we will say, "God, any way you bless me, I will be satisfied." Do I have any witnesses who's watching me this morning that any way you bless me, God, I will be satisfied because I realize that you've already done what you said you would do, and you really don't have to do anything else for me. So God, if you choose, if you decide to give me this blessing, to give me this miracle, I will be satisfied. So it is that we see that faith humbles us. The last thing, and I'm getting ready to close here, and it says in the 28th verse, then Jesus replied to her, "Woman, your faith is great. Let it be done for you as you want." And from that moment, her daughter was healed. My brothers and my sisters, not only do we learn that faith is persistent and faith humbles us, but lastly, we must recognize that faith grants us access. Jesus praises this mother for the faith that she has. He not only acknowledges her faith, but the text shows us that he grants her request. Jesus listens to the woman because of her humility and persistence. He answers her request because of her faith. Hallelujah. Because when you have persistence without faith, it's worthless. And when you don't have humility, and when you don't demonstrate your willingness to take whatever God gives you, your faith and all of that is pointless. But Jesus, he responds to the faith this woman has. And how many of us understand that Jesus will respond to our faith? We face challenges that can help stretch and strengthen our faith, and we face issues that people may would think that would deter us from Jesus. But my brothers and my sisters, that even in the midst of those challenges, we must be determined to press on. We must be persistent. We must be consistent, because our faith will pay off after a while. We understand that sometimes the going gets rough, but we have to learn how to press forward. We understand that sometimes we can't see the end of the road, but we have to learn how to press forward. Sometimes it's so dark, and sometimes we can't see the end of the tunnel, but we have to learn how to press forward. And my brothers and my sisters, if we learn how to do like this woman does, if we learn how to just continue to trust and depend on Jesus, if we learn how to just keep on praising him even in the midst of the storm, we will see the hand of God. We will see God turn things around. We will see how God brings us out, how God will bring us through. Why? Because there's something about faith. Faith moves God. And I know that even in this pandemic, even in this situation where it seems like everything is crazy, I want to encourage you to keep your faith, because your faith is going to carry you through. I know it doesn't look like it, but keep your faith. I know that you're hurting down on the inside, but keep your faith. I know you're trying to figure out how bills are going to be paid and how ways are going to be made. But even when Jesus is silent, you have to continue to keep your faith, because your faith will give you the victory. Your faith will give you access to the blessing of the Lord. And so, my brothers and my sisters, I want you to be encouraged. We can learn some lessons from the faith of this mother. My brothers and my sisters, faith is the key. Faith is the key. We must continue to maintain our faith. Let us pray. Father God, in Jesus' name, Lord, we come to you now. Lord, we thank you again for all that you have done. I pray, God, that this sermon has encouraged someone, because perhaps they're in that place where it seems that you are silent, where you're not saying anything, as shown in this text, how you didn't say a word to this woman at first. Some of us, God, may feel that we're at that point where you're not speaking. But God, I pray that we will not give up. We will not throw in the towel. But I pray that we will be persistent in our faith. God, I pray that we will allow faith to humble us and not allow us to have an arrogance or a spirit of entitlement, because God, we realize that you don't have to do anything for us. God, you've already done enough when you sent Jesus. That's all that you had to do. But God, anything else that you may do for us, we count it a privilege. We count it an honor. God, we count it a blessing. And so God, I pray that, God, that your people will be strengthened. Your people will be lifted. If there's anyone who's listening to me, God, who's not saved, pray, God, that you will save them. God, we know that you're still in the saving business. And so God, I pray that they will confess you. I pray, God, that they will allow you to come into their heart. God, we just thank you. God, we just honor you. And God, we just give you the praise. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you, my brothers and my sisters. Thank you again for joining us on today. And if you want to be a blessing to Mount Pisgah Church, simply you can go to our website. You can Google us. Go to our website. There is a place on our website where you're able to give. Also, you can search us on Givelify, Mount Pisgah Missionary Baptist Church, Rayford, North Carolina. So if you want to be a blessing to this ministry, because we recognize we're only able to do what we do because of the support of various individuals. So if you want to be a blessing, please do so, and keep the Mount Pisgah Church lifted up. Keep me lifted up as we continue to press forward and do what it is that God has called us to do. God bless you.